a mobile mobile environment. All right. If you look around, while it's true that you can write an adaptive or responsive page to tweak the content and make it look different on a mobile versus on a desktop environment, the truth is, actually, most larger websites, there are two different versions of it. All right. For example, let me grab my phone here, which I don't know where it is. It might be up on my desk upstairs. Here it is. If we go and visit lorainecc.edu, we will see a different page on the mobile browser than we will for the desktop. And it's not like it's just like tweaked slightly. It's not like it is similar to what we've seen in other examples. I'm trying to pull up that page. And actually, I lied. They are making revisions to the page, and now the mobile site points to the same page. Let's try another site. Let's pull up Amazon. And if we were going to look at this, here is Amazon website on my phone. And we'll compare that to how it looks on a desktop browser. That's how it looks like there. Notice the URL even. The URL is different. It's not www.amazon.com. There's some stuff after it. All right. And all I typed in my mobile browser was amazon.com. And it went to that. And you look, if you compare that to the desktop, this is how it looks on a desktop environment. So there's some consistent content between the two, yet they're two different pages. At a certain point, the decision that you have to make is it worth it to try to make an adaptive site that works both in a mobile environment and on a desktop environment, or is it simply going to be easier to make two different pages? And it's just a matter of the difference, what the difference is between the two environments and how much of a difference there is between the two environments, how much content is on the page. What you think the goals, or how do you think the goals are different from the person visiting your page via a desktop browser versus visiting it via a mobile page? All those things sort of give you the answer to that question. If there aren't too many different goals between a desktop and a mobile user, if they have similar goals, and really you're accounting for mainly the difference in the size of the screen, then you might be able to take one website and using these adaptive and responsive techniques, get it to work both in a mobile or in a desktop environment. If, however, you have a massive website where there's all sorts of functionality in it, all right, and you know that the goals of the people visiting the mobile site are drastically different, then it might just be better saying, well, we might be able to stretch an adaptive site to handle both of these, but it's better to just break and have two separate sites. So what we're going to do is we're going to look at that. We're going to talk a little bit about how that's going to work. And we'll talk about things that we're going to do to sort of mitigate the problem of now we have two websites. Does that mean twice the work? All right? The hope is that it doesn't mean twice the work. One additional consideration I think that I mentioned is if we hide things via CSS, the browser still downloads them. So you may think, well, on a responsive mobile site, I'm not downloading an image or whatever. Well, that image will still be downloaded, again, depending on the technique that you use to hide it, all right, depending on exactly how. So we talked about in our overview of the different technologies, we talked about how we have the client requesting a web page through the internet, it goes to a web server, and we get back HTML, CSS, and JavaScript. So far, we've done most of our work in CSS. That is, we've made everything fluid based on percentages, not absolute numbers. And then we used media queries to apply a style sheet only in certain circumstances. Last time we went through a little example where we used JavaScript to tweak a page once it got loaded. So we made it so that as the user resizes the page, it addresses that. All right. JavaScript works on a page that's already loaded. JavaScript depends on the fact that the page has been loaded and then allows you to make some small tweaks to it. If you remember last time, what we did is as the page got resized, we hid a certain div once it got smaller in a certain amount, based on the width of the page. When you think of JavaScript again, think of changing a page that already exists. So that's the purpose of client-side scripting, is being able to change a page that has been loaded without going back to the server. All right? There's scripting also on the server side, called server-side scripting. And that has a slightly different purpose. The purpose of server-side scripting is to customize the page based on any number of factors. So it's going to create on the fly a page custom for the user. Or rather, let me rephrase that, custom for the request. All right? Now, server-side scripting is used for things long before there was such a thing as mobile devices. All right? Server-side scripting is what allows web pages to be more than just informational web pages that, you know, like sort of an electronic magazine or electronic brochure or something like that. And allows us to create interactive applications where you can do things. You can order books on Amazon, or you can search for things in the library, or search for things on Google. All right? And the notion of server-side scripting is this. And let's compare it so that we make sure we understand the difference between it and client-side scripting. In server-side scripting, the page is generated on the fly when the user requests it, as opposed to plain old HTML pages, which are sitting out there in their completed form, and all the web server does is deliver them. So let's talk about the first lab assignment that you did in CISS 216. Static, plain old HTML page. If you looked at it today, you know, depending on, you know, I mean, if you were to pull it off of your thumb drive and pull it up and look at it, it would look identical to how it looked the day that you turned it in. right? Because it's just plain old HTML. All right? And plain old HTML documents don't change unless someone manually goes in and changes those documents. All right? Now, how is server-side scripting different? Server-side scripting, with server-side scripting, you don't have completed web pages out there. You have instructions to create a web page. You have server-side scripting code that creates a web page. And that code, then, when you request a web page, it doesn't simply deliver an existing web page, but it generates a page specific to your request. So it can take into account any number of factors. All right? It can take account, for one thing, what you've entered in on the form. All right? It can take into account another thing, your geographical location. So we went over the example last time, right at the very end of class, where I went into Google, and searched for Italian restaurants. And when I did that, it brought me a list of Italian restaurants that are in the area. So, this web page of results was customized at least two different ways, and maybe more ways. Really, how Google does its searching is fascinating. There's a great book called The Filter Bubble that is not in LC's library, but in the Elyria library that's, you know, on the first floor, that talks about Google personalization. In a way, it's kind of scary, all right? But the good news of it from a technology viewpoint is it can give us much more focused results. Because if I Googled so many years ago Italian restaurants, it would show me Italian restaurants all over the world that wouldn't really be relevant to me. But here it's smart enough to take into account where I geographically am. And it returns a list of Italian restaurants local to this area. All right. So, this page was made custom for me. It doesn't show Chinese restaurants because I didn't type in Chinese restaurants. I typed in Italian restaurants. All right. It doesn't show me Italian bakeries because I didn't type in Italian bakeries. I typed in Italian restaurants. And it's customized based on my location as well. All right. So, when you think of server-side scripting, think of creating on the fly a web page specific to the request that was made. All right, specific to the request that's made. And again, that could be based on any number of different factors. Here it was based on what I entered in on the form, which is one very common way to provide information to a server-side script. And the second thing is based on the location. All right. Well, how does it know my location? Did I log in somewhere? You know, I might have, but no. It knows it based on the IP address. It's able to look at the request that comes in. All right. The request that comes in, and it can analyze and look at the IP address and know who owns the IP address and who the internet service provider is, blah, blah, blah. And usually it can come up with a pretty good idea of where I'm located in, of where I'm located. All right? So, when you make a request to the server, along with the URL that you're requesting, all right, you can send form information, and then there's a lot of stuff that gets sent automatically as part of the request. All right? In this case, without us knowing it, it sent the IP address. All right, so it knows the IP address that we're coming from. It kind of has to know the IP address, right, to get it back to us. All right. But it's able to take that information and then do something with it to customize the page. Even though we didn't explicitly say we're in Elyria, our request gives it that information. And then it can do something with it. So, this isn't a class on server-side scripting, but I do want to touch on it in case some of you have not done this, and talk about the idea behind it, and then we'll talk about some straightforward examples. Now, the whole purpose of server-side scripting is to customize a page for a request. You know, maybe personalize would be another way to say it. All right? Both of us can go to Angel, and both of us can go to the same page on Angel, but your page is going to look different. It's going to be personalized to you. It's going to show the classes that you're in. All right? And mine's going to show the classes that I'm teaching. In addition, if both of us went to this class, even though we're both in the class, my screen is still going to look different from you because I'm the instructor in the class and I have different rights and permissions than you do as a student in this class. So, therefore, that couldn't be done with plain old HTML. All right? It would not be very efficient and it really wouldn't make sense to try to do it on the client side. What you really want to do is you want to generate, every time the page is requested, a page custom for the user based on all the different parameters. So based on the time of day it could take into account, based on where you're physically located, based on who you're logged in as, based on all these parameters, it takes it into account and it can generate a page for you. Now, one of the parameters that's important with mobile devices and in this discussion of using server-side scripting to have two separate pages is called the user agent. The user agent is essentially it's another way of saying a browser. It's how you're accessing the internet. All right? How you're accessing the internet. So what the server-side script can do is it can look at the user agent, and based on the user agent, it can come to some conclusions. All right? There is a web page listed in the book. I don't think this is it. No, I'm not displaying it. Listed in the book. I don't have my book with me, but I have. We'll see it in a minute when I look at my example. But here's a page that does similar to the example of the page in the book. It's simply whatismyuseragent.com. And what it does is it's showing me, it knows that I am using a Mozilla-based browser, which is the Chrome and the Firefoxes of the world. All right, and it knows my IP address. So from the IP address, the web server can get my location. And from the user agent, it knows that I'm a desktop machine as opposed to being a mobile device. If we were to view this same page using Internet Explorer, it'll show you something else. We're running Microsoft IE 7.0. So based on these things, it can make some decisions of what to do. I've even seen cases where if you go to a page to download some software, it will look, and if you're on a Mac, it gives you the link to download a Mac, the Mac version of the software. If you're on Windows, it gives you the link to do that. So there's all kinds of ways that the server can look at information about you and about your request, and then customize the response based on certain parameters. Here's the idea of what we're going to do. And we're going to follow through an example of a book, and then in later weeks, we're going to expand upon it. All right? We are going to write a web page that serves as a traffic cop. We're going to have a page that the first thing that page does is it looks at the user agent. If it decides that it's on a mobile device, it is going to redirect me to a mobile version of the page. And again, the mobile version of the page can be written, again, taking into account the fact that people visiting a user or people using a mobile device to visit a web page is likely to have or likely to have different goals than someone visiting the same page on a desktop. So that page can be sort of optimized for the mobile experience. Now, thing is we're still going to use the responsive and adaptive techniques on these pages, because just because we've identified it being a mobile device, there's still a wide range of the sizes of mobile devices. There's another little catch, if you will. All right? And that little catch is that it's possible that this little snippet of code guesses wrong. All right? In other words, user agent detection is not necessarily a science. All right? We can define what our best guess is for that, but for any number of reasons, it's possible that the web server guesses wrong, in which case we want this page to be adaptive. So ideally, we want to direct all mobile traffic over to this page, but we make this page adaptive just in case someone gets it. Additionally, what often is done as well in a mobile-only site is there'll be a link back to the full site. So, for example, if I visited a website and I got the mobile version of it, they anticipated the things that I would want to do on the mobile site, but maybe there's something I want to do that only exists on the full site. I should be able to link over to that as well. And if I do link over to it, it should look well on my mobile device. So it should use the adaptive techniques. So, in order for this to work, I can't work with basic HTML files anymore. I have to work with some server-side language. And we're going to use PHP in this class. And I can no longer simply double-click on my web pages and open them if I'm using PHP. I have to request them from a web server. All right? Now, I had thought the web server software was installed on this machine, but as it turns out, it wasn't, which might be good, because if I have permissions to install it, I can walk through the installation process that you're likely to go through. If you want to install it. If I can't do it, then I have plan B. You know, you always got to have plan B. All right? So we'll go from this. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go to Angel and as I look at this class, one of the options on the main menu is installing a web development environment. And it's pointing to an application called XAMPP. What XAMPP does is it installs sort of the open source web environment. What is the open source web environment? It is a collection of, typically, Apache as the web server. What is a web server? It's the software that listens for requests that people are making for a web page and fulfills them. With plain old HTML pages, you don't need a web server. You can just click on, double-click on them, open them up, and there they are. But for any server-side scripting, you can't just simply open up the script in a web browser. That script has to be processed. All right? The server-side script is like, think of it like a recipe. It's the instructions to create a web page, not a web page itself. And therefore, what you have to do is you have to go and request that page from the web server, and then the web server brings that, those instructions, brings that page to life and actually displays the page. So, in the open source world, Apache is the web server. So that's the A part. M is for MySQL, which is a database. P is for PHP or also Perl. These are server-side languages. All right. Now, these have their counterpart in the Microsoft world, of course. With Microsoft, the web server is IIS. The database is SQL Server. And the languages, or the web platform, is ASP.NET and C#, typically. This is a proprietary platform, which means that only Microsoft makes changes to this. This is an open source platform, which means the open source community actually goes in and can change it and enhance it. In fact, any person can go in and tweak something if there's a bug or an issue. All right? There's versions of this for Windows and Linux and Macintosh environment. Macintosh's operating system. All right, OS X. Sort of the full-blown open-source experience would not use Windows at all, but would use Linux as the operating system. But again, we have Windows machines, and we're going to install on top of that the open-source web environment. So let's go here. I went to that website. I'm going to click download. Hope that it works. Download the setup file. Click run. Follow the easy installer steps. Step 4, enjoy your software. I like that. Okay. I've been bamboozled. Oh, my Lord. Oh. No. Not again. I'll be darned.
Up at the top.
Okay. Wow. There we go. All right, let's try this one. Let's see. Looking for later. Okay, we'll download that one. While you're waiting, download, please take a moment. I do not want to do that. All right. There we go, finally. Normally I catch that, but the They had me this time. They got me this time. I admit it. Right, right. Well, they're giving it to you for free. So, you know, in a way, yeah, you know, they got to get paid somehow. I remember, it's funny, one virus that I was not vulnerable to was the I Love You virus. I don't know if you remember that one. That was several years back where there was an email that, you know, came from people in your address book, and the subject line was I Love You. And then you click on the link and it would take you somewhere, and of course it would install the virus. Number of people where I worked, which was a software consulting company, fell for it. I did not, largely because, you know, perhaps I'm cynical, but I see an email labeled I Love You, I know it's probably a virus. I know it isn't someone, yeah, no one loves me that much, right? You know, not to have a poor self-image here, but the people that were susceptible to flattery, on the other hand, like, ooh, this person loves me, let me go and look at it, and then they got virused. Okay. This is going through the motions. Maybe I do have time to take this survey. We'll let it download and we'll continue talking about this. The nice thing about this package is that it installs everything all in one shot. Typically, if you're doing open source web development, you want Apache, PHP, and MySQL. It's not to say you can't run PHP on an IIS machine or use PHP with a SQL Server database or any of those other things, but typically, again, it's written, you know, typically the typical usage is to use all these open source packages. So this allows you to go and install them all in one shot. And so it's a pretty nifty thing, and it's pretty straightforward once it finally does download. While we're doing that, I'm going to go and I'm going to bring the code down that we're going to use as the example for today. And we'll start to look at the code, even though we can't run it yet. All right. Looking at this, notice that my web pages aren't .html. They're .php. That indicates that they're PHP files. I'm still going to use, I mean, these are still web pages. They're just web pages that get created in a different way. All right? And so I'm still going to use CSS. I'm still going to use my images and so on. But my web pages aren't plain HTML, they're PHP. Now, what does it mean when I say a page is PHP? I mean this. Let's open up, for example, index. All right. This looks, or this should look, a lot like a plain old HTML document, because it is. Because what PHP is a mixture, it's a blend of regular plain old HTML code plus some special PHP code which runs and is partly responsible for generating the page. So it's a mix of plain old HTML and some stuff that gets filled in by the script. Now the advantage is that script can be as simple or as complicated as you want to make it. So the script can have all kinds of processing logic to look at the location of the person, to look at what they put in on the form, to look at any number of different parameters and customize their search results just for them. All right? Whereas plain old HTML can't do that. Now, how do you know if you're using, you know, I said it's a mix of HTML and PHP code. How do you know which is which? The PHP code is enclosed between these little declaratives. All right? In other words, this, which I hope you can see, lesson sign, question mark, PHP, says we are no longer in HTML land. We're in PHP land. And everything from everything from here to here is PHP code. This indicates that we're done with PHP. So we go back into HTML land. So I really just have two little pieces of PHP in this page. All right? The one piece of PHP is this piece up here. And the second piece of PHP is this little piece here, which when we run this, we'll see it. That's responsible for displaying on the screen the user agent that the person has. All right? Let's check on our download. All right, let's go and run it. All right, you get to place a location. You have some options. I'm going to take the defaults. And it looks like it's letting me install it. And it's doing its thing. Tell you what, we'll go back to our code and continue talking about it, and I'll keep an eye on this, and when this is done, we'll come back and actually run our code. So, in our PHP file, we have this section of PHP code and this section of PHP code. The rest of it's plain old HTML. Let's look at what this section does so we're ready when we see it. This section up here is a user agent detection that's going to detect if I'm on a mobile browser or not. And this is code that I just went out and got from this website. I don't know what I did. I typed in the name slightly incorrectly when I was looking for it before. Detect mobile browsers. What you can do is you can actually generate scripts in PHP, Perl, Python, Rails, JavaScript, jQuery, any number of different languages. And so what I can do is I can say, all right, if it's a mobile if it's not a mobile browser, take them to this page. desktop.php. Otherwise, send them to this page, mobile.php. And then I can click to download the script. And that script is simply that piece that I had at the beginning of my PHP page. So I simply went and copied that it generated from there up to here. And I'm ready to go. The nice thing is assuming that this is maintained well, this site is maintained well, as new mobile browsers are introduced, they're updating these scripts. So, it'll take into account the new mobile browser, so you won't have potentially the case of misidentifying it. All right. So I went to this site and I snagged this script and I put it at the beginning of my code. All right. Now, We're gonna sort of just look at this on an overview level. We don't necessarily need to get into all the nuts and bolts of it here. This is essentially a two-line script. Number one, this is a PHP command for me to pull from the request what my user agent is. All right? So that's the line of code in PHP that says, hey, look at the request. That's what that $_server means. It means the request that came in. And pull from that the user agent. You'll notice that in PHP, the variable names start with a dollar sign. So $userAgent, that might look a little odd to you. That's simply a variable. It's simply pulling the value of the user agent and storing it in a variable called userAgent. The next line looks at that user agent and sees if it is one of these mobile devices. All right, is it an Android, Avant Go, BlackBerry, IE Mobile, Kindle, and so on down the line. It's looking to see if it's one of those mobile devices. And you see, notice there's a whole string of things. All right? So we should be happy that we don't have to write this, right? Because that would be a real mess. All right? But in a nutshell, what it's doing is it's looking at that user agent variable, and it's saying yay or nay. Yay, this is a mobile browser that's accessing this page. Or no, it's not a mobile browser. So if this if statement is true, this whole if statement here, in other words, if it is one of the mobile browsers, we execute this statement. And what this statement does is it redirects them to the mobile page. All right? So the first thing we do in our home page is we look to see, are they in a mobile environment or not? If they're in a mobile environment, we send them to a mobile page. Otherwise, if that if statement is false, the page just continues along and they display the full pages version, the full sites version, the desktop sites version. So that's like the traffic cop. It either says, yes, they're on a mobile device, send them to the mobile page, or it lets them continue and display this page. All right, let's check on our install. Looks like it's been finished. All right, with this, we have a little control panel that runs down here. And I can go and I can start everything. I'm going to start Apache. And that's all I need to start, Apache and MySQL. All right, I don't, for this example, I don't need to start MySQL. So I'll start the Apache web server. Now, what does this mean? This means that this machine sitting right here, now has web server software running on it. Now, it's not out there on the internet. Other people can't access it. But I can make requests to the web server software running on this machine, which means that I don't have to just pull up static HTML pages. I can pull up PHP pages now. Remember, PHP pages require a server to bring them to life. PHP pages are just recipes, instructions for pages. Now, what is the name of my web server? What is the name of my site? For every machine, if you type in localhost, that is the name of your site. All right? So, what we have right here, as I type in localhost, it brings up this splash screen, and that simply means that everything got installed correctly. All right, there's probably some documentation there as well. So, after you install this on your machine, and you mess up and install some flash viewer or whatever it is I was about to install, then you go back and undo it and go and do this, If you've done it correctly, if you go up to your address bar in your browser and type in localhost, you should see that screen. That's a sign that you installed it correctly. That means now your machine is waiting, listening for requests. All right? Now, how do you get to request one of your pages? Well, you have to put the pages in a place where the web server knows about them. So let's look at where we installed this guy. And we installed this guy in XAMPP. And inside XAMPP, there's a page called, or not a page, but a folder called htdocs. That's where your web pages go. So I installed this inside XAMPP. Inside of XAMPP, there will be a subfolder called htdocs, and htdocs is where your web pages go. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go and I'm going to copy my folder, my lectures folder, I'm going to copy it into my htdocs folder. So now it's inside the htdocs folder. So, how do I access my page? My page, if you notice, is called index.php. All right? It's in a folder called lecture that is off my htdocs folder. So htdocs is considered to be my web server's root folder. That's sort of ground zero, the base for it. So since this is in a subfolder called lecture, and the file name is index.php, I would access this by going to my browser and typing in localhost slash lecture slash index.php. All right? And that will go, and it will bring up my web page. All right? That is that PHP page. Now, if I do a view source, I don't see any of that PHP code, right? Because the PHP code runs on the server, creates an HTML document, and then the HTML document is what gets sent to the browser. So your browser's always seeing HTML code. All right? Your browser never executes. Your browser doesn't know PHP code. Your browser only knows HTML, CSS, and JavaScript. So therefore, if you want to run a PHP page to dynamically create a web page, it has to get processed first by a web server. So that's why we went through this whole exercise of creating the web server. Then we put our files in where the web server can recognize it, and now we can access those pages by simply typing in the URL localhost slash lecture slash index.php. Questions about this? This would be something I would suggest you do. The next assignment is likely to have something about this on it to do a redirect. Now, notice, again, when I go and access that page, it says the word full site, and it has this little snippet of code in here, which is the result of this PHP command. That PHP command says echo, or output, spit out, your user agent. And so that's what it does. It shows me the user agent string. That's the string that this if statement used up here to identify whether it was a mobile device or not. Now it's spitting it out. Now, what if we execute this through the mobile emulator? Let me copy the URL. And let me open up the mobile emulator. And we'll say we're on an HTC an HTC Hero. I can go up here and I can put in that address, localhost, all right? And notice what it says. And there's a little problem with this, and I'll go and fix it in a minute here. This, what page is this? Notice what happened. They got redirected, the user got redirected to localhost lecture mobile.php. So, in other words, this index.php ran in the mobile emulator. It grabbed the user agent. It tested to see what the user agent was and decided, hey, I'm on a mobile browser. And therefore, this if statement was true, this statement got executed, and this statement, the header location mobile.php, sent the mobile browser to the mobile version of the page. So instead of getting index.php, they got mobile.php, which is a simpler page. All right. Has a different style sheet associated with it, has still outputting the text and all that, and so on. So it got sent to a different page. Now you can imagine, again, whatever differences you want on the mobile page versus desktop page, you can accomplish this way. You can put all the stuff for the desktop page on the desktop version, all the code for the mobile page on the mobile. Now, again, the question you might ask yourself is, doesn't that involve maybe writing some stuff two times? Well, we're going to figure out a way to keep from that happening. For one thing, notice that even though we have two different pages, we're using the same style sheets in them. The mobile page just gets the base style sheet. All right, so the mobile page just gets the base style sheet. The desktop version, the full site, gets the mobile, or gets the base style sheet, plus this additional full style sheet. So again, we're doing the progressive enhancement. The base style sheet contains just a rudimentary, just a basic look for basic mobile devices, and then we add on top of that any additional styling that we want for a desktop, and we put it in there. And we put it in there with a media query, just on the odd chance that someone got here by mistake and they're not really on a desktop. So that's an additional assurance. Now, if you notice, this is hard to read in the mobile emulator. All right, and that's because there's a line that I always forget to put in my mobile versions of the page that I'm going to go and put in now. And it's a line that relates to the viewport. There's a meta tag that relates to the viewport. And so I'm going to go and I'm going to copy that into my mobile page in the head section. All right. Now if I go and, did I save it? Now if I go and refresh this, all right, let's go and create another. Now if I go and paste this URL into my mobile browser, notice how it looks a lot nicer now. It's optimized and it's bigger. So don't forget that. If it appears looking really tiny in your mobile browser, you probably forgot it like I did. All right. So I'll re-upload this example, including the viewport in it. I uploaded it earlier today, and I'll upload it with that. So again, the idea is simple. All right. We're using PHP really for just two things in this case. We're using PHP to display, in both cases, the user agent, right? That can't be put in HTML because everyone has a different user agent. It has to be something that's custom or personalized for the person making the request. Because if I were to view this page then using IE, again, the user agent's going to give me something different than if I view it using Chrome. All right. Same pages, same page, rather, being requested, one through the Internet Explorer, one through Chrome, and again, it gives you the different user agent each there. You couldn't do that in HTML. That would require some sort of scripting, and specifically it requires, in this case, server-side scripting. That's what this line of code does. Well, I output the user agent. And on this one, I output the user agent as well. Probably for all of these, it will say it's the Opera mobile browser because we're running the Opera mobile emulator. All right. So that's one piece of PHP coding we have. This little snippet in here that just spits out the user agent. All right. The more relevant piece of coding we have is this chunk here. And this is the traffic cop. Alright, this needs to be at the top of your PHP script. You can't start to develop a web page and then go and redirect them. So in other words, this statement here, this header statement that sends the user to a different page, has to be in there prior to sending, outputting anything else. So that has to be near the top of the page. Again, we're grabbing the user agent. We're testing it up against these predefined patterns, and if it finds a mobile device, it sends them to this page. If it doesn't find a mobile device, it simply continues on and displays the full version of the page. Questions about this? All right. So, now we have choices. Again, like I said, this class is all about adding tools to your tool belt. And one choice, or one tool, doesn't mean that we're going to stop using the other ones. These are used in a mix and match sort of thing. So, the first round of things, the first round of examples and lectures and assignments says, started with the idea that we're going to have one single web page, and we are going to put code in it, such as media queries, and we're going to design our CSS such that one web page will be adaptive or responsive. So it will display okay on a mobile device or on a desktop. And that's okay, provided that you want the mobile page to be pretty similar to the desktop. All right? At a certain point, if the differences between what you want the mobile page to be and what you want the desktop page to be, if those differences become too much, you're likely to say, I'm not going to try to make one page that fits both, even using all these wonderful adaptive techniques. Even though I might be able to do it, it's going to be very messy. And I'm better off then, because the user goals are different in those two environments, I'm better off making a page just for mobile, making a page just for desktop. When you do that, when you develop those pages, don't forget everything you've learned about responsive design. All right? Why not? Well, as I mentioned before, mobile devices covers a wide range of things, right? From a nice big old tablet to a tiny little phone. So there's still a wide range there. You still want your pages to be adaptive. All right? In addition, there's always a chance that a page will somehow misidentify and will think it's not on a mobile device even though it is. All right, there's a bug in that script, for example. All right, in which case, you would want to make sure that, hey, if they get sent to the wrong page by mistake, it still looks pretty good. All right. Now, again, the challenge that we'll take up probably next time when we do this is, okay, we need to have a mobile version of the page, and we need the mobile page to be a different web page than the desktop page because there's a big enough difference between the two. Does that mean I'm going to have to do everything twice? Does that mean I'm going to have to create a navigation twice and a footer twice and a header twice and so on down the line? And I sure hope the answer is no, right? Because we don't want to do duplicate work, all right? If there's something that can be shared between the two, we want to be able to do that. Now, we've already seen in this example us sharing CSS code. Both the mobile and the desktop version use that base CSS. So that's a start. But we need a way to share PHP code and HTML code. And that's where we get into what are called PHP include files. PHP include files allow us to take a chunk of code, put it in a separate file, and then bring that file in to as many places as we want. Sort of like we do with our external CSS files. So that will allow us not to have to duplicate code. If there's something that appears both on the desktop and the full version, we don't have to duplicate that code. We can put it in a PHP include file and bring that include file in both places. Questions about any of this? My suggestion would be to install that XAMPP platform and get it up and running in your environment because, again, starting with the next assignment, we're going to be doing things that involve some server-side scripting. We're going to start out small and we're going to build on it. Now, this is not a class in server-side scripting, all right? So my hope is, you know, we're not going to be too intimidating. We're not going to be doing great many of fancy PHP stuff. But we're going to learn the basics that relate to, number one, redirection, which we just saw an example of up there, and number two, sharing code between two different versions of the page. And that's pretty straightforward. So if you're intimidated, like, wow, I have to learn another language, we're only going to be touching on the PHP stuff in here. Similar to, we're only going to be doing some small JavaScript examples. So don't let that intimidate you at all. Questions? All right. I will make sure that I upload this version of the example because it has a viewport meta tag that I forgot. And then we'll see you either in lab or next week.